and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where, wow, what a roller coaster of emotion! And I'm not just talking about Star Wars. Well, mostly Star Wars, but we do have an unusual amount of box office news to go over today. Chapter times down below in the video description, as always. But it's all very juicy, so I can't wait to break it down with you. But yes, The Rise of Skywalker rose at the box office Christmas week, like throughout the week. And the industry is saying that it's thanks to word of mouth, meaning that despite the wet blanket critics and the evil fandom menace, general audiences enjoy this movie. But do they? I mean, let's not forget the B+ cinema score, which is the lowest ever for the live-action movies in this franchise. I mean, Solo got an A-, yet word of mouth didn't save that movie. I think it's more that Star Wars at Christmas has become a powerful tradition for many. Impossible to resist, maybe. And sure enough, the next especially since there isn't really much of a challenge. Well, we're going to break this all down. It's very interesting. Disney, continuously too big to fail. But anyway, the next trilogy, which still has its release dates despite losing its directors, that will remain still a Christmas tradition. Disney ain't going nowhere. They're like, never blink, never surrender. And it's working. Now, maybe if Solo, who knows, maybe if Solo had opened at Christmas instead of infamously being moved to Memorial Day weekend to make room for Mary Poppins Returns, which it turns out didn't need that much room, well, maybe Solo wouldn't have been a flop either. Maybe it would have rallied and everyone would have been like, I don't care, I'm seeing Star Wars for Christmas. That could have happened. Because, I think Solo was actually worse than The Rise of Skywalker. The Rise of Skywalker is such a mess from a filmmaking perspective, which I think counts for a lot of the critics' ratings. But it is watchable. It's more than watchable, right? And we should also factor in people simply wanting to finish the story, especially when they're off from school and work, and going out to the movies is still, whew, thank goodness, something people like to do. I mean, that's cause to celebrate right there. So if you're a little upset that The Rise of Skywalker is doing well, just be happy that the movie business is also doing very well. You know, maybe The Mandalorian also helped make things seem not so bleak. And maybe some who boycotted the film opening weekend couldn't hold out during Christmas week. They're like, I want to send a message, but I don't have anything to do. Was that you? All right, so, I mean, my family went to see Jumanji. They did not care for it. Jumanji, though, as you'll see, you know, did pretty well over Christmas as well. But my family actually was like, maybe we should have seen Star Wars. And I was like, the complaints you have about Jumanji, they thought it was boring. I was like, you're definitely going to feel that way about Star Wars since half of you didn't see The Last Jedi even, although maybe that would have helped. But yeah, I think, you know, people are like, I want to go out to the movies, and a big sci-fi spectacle from Disney doesn't sound so bad. Certainly doesn't keep, it'll be worth my time at the theater. I think you have to think about, you know, industry people versus like hardcore fans versus the general moviegoer. And there are more general moviegoers than anyone else in those groups. So that's always, and I think that's the sweet spot for Disney. That's where they always win. Because people are going to see The Rise of Skywalker. It posted the second biggest Christmas Day gross of all time. And look at that list! Christmas tradition indeed. All Star Wars movies. And The Rise of Skywalker, 10 days out, is now only $6.3 million behind The Last Jedi. How'd that happen? And with no new films hitting the multiplex in January, the industry is now, you know, very positive. They're believing that The Rise of Skywalker, I don't know how much they believe it and how much they're putting it out there in the hopes that by putting it out in the world, it'll happen. But they feel that The Rise of Skywalker can match The Last Jedi 620.1 domestic run. Now, at only 361.8, I think that seems a bit premature to me. I doubt people will watch The Rise of Skywalker through January. But through the next week of vacation, that I think they will do. Especially because, again, there are no new releases. There's one on Friday, which we'll discuss, The Grudge. But nothing's coming out for New Year's Day. And with around 700 million already in the tank worldwide for The Rise of Skywalker, one more week could take it to a billion, or close enough that it gets there in a few more days. Because it took The Last Jedi 19 days to get there. And we're at day 10, and what do you know? 9 more days would cover the next holiday weeks, you know, 7 and change. So it's very, very doable. So does this mean that Star Wars, no matter how unhappy that you might be, is it unbeatable at Christmas? Right now, Interestingly enough, Disney is playing release date chicken, one of our favorite games, with Warner Brothers over the 12/16/22 release date. Because Warner Brothers called dibs on the date back in February for Aquaman 2, but then Disney laid claim to it a few months later in July. Now, Warner Brothers lost their last game of release date chicken with Disney. That was really infamous. You know, again, they weren't even going to make Civil War, but then when they announced Batman v Superman, Kevin Feige was like, maybe we should make Civil War, and they were open just a month or so apart. It was dark times. And I think that Warner Brothers will likely blink again, especially if that Star Wars movie in 2022 ends up being the Kevin Feige Star Wars movie. Because Disney, no matter who's making that movie, they ain't gonna blink. They're already missing two Christmases for Star Wars because they're taking the self-imposed break. In 2020, Disney Fox will release West Side Story for Christmas. I think that's gonna be another Mary Poppins Returns situation, but we'll see. And in 2021, Avatar 2. So what Disney is hoping to do starting in 20, so they don't really only have 1 year off, and then they're hoping to dominate Christmas for the rest of time because they'll just alternate between Star Wars and Avatar movies. And that might work, to be honest with you. The other studios are like, we lost Christmas forever. Don't do it, fight. It's hard though, it's hard. No, I mean, Disney has amazing brands. But speaking of their brands, I still feel that you'll see significant change at Lucasfilm. Disney barely survived this, and they don't need all this contentious debate around their properties. Disney doesn't like controversy. Nobody does, really, but Disney is especially not that kind of studio. They're not supposed to be. They actually have a tremendous amount of controversy. All right, so anyway, J.J. Abrams is already headed to Warner Brothers with a massive deal, like north of $500 million to go make movies over there. Probably take over D.C. We'll see. That's what they would like him to do. And I suspect Kathleen Kennedy will get her own massive producing deal, likely at Disney. Just like Amy Pascal stayed at Sony after being fired as the head of that studio. After the email scandal. So Kathleen Kennedy won't make Star Wars movies anymore, but I think she'll probably stay at Disney. I think to not only save face herself, but for the studio to save face. I think everyone, cast included, will be able to leave Star Wars with their heads held high with this box office performance. And also some of you will be like, and a B+ isn't that bad, Grace. But remember, Terminator Dark Fate also has a B+. A B+ is not a great grade, because audiences, again, general audiences, are very positive, and so you should really be somewhere in the A range. A+, A-. And then I think Lucasfilm will do a soft reset on Disney+. You know, not restarting the story, but, you know, kind of just like getting a fresh creative bath, right? Before likely roaring back to life on the big screen in 2022. Now, unlike other studios, Disney has always insisted on boldly forging ahead no matter what, feeling the problems will work themselves out, because no problem is big enough to defeat their powerful brands. And for the most part, Disney is right. They just keep moving. Bob Iger made the incredible concession that they maybe put out too many Star Wars movies. That's all he said. He didn't say, we messed up by focusing on the original trilogy cast and the new cast at the same time. He was just like, maybe it was too many. That was the most he was willing to say. And they'll fire people like the head of the theme parks recently, but they're not going to publicly admit to anything, which I understand. Totally get it, as long as the changes are made. You don't have to acknowledge it. And I think here, you know, other studios stop and start all the time, perhaps too often. But Disney, as they get started, as they prepare to make one of the first stops they've ever made with Star Wars taking this break, Bob Iger has brilliantly found, as I just said, another benefit to streaming services, and that's the ability to keep the brand in the public eye and maybe even repair it while making that much-needed stop at the feature film level. And streaming services could perhaps be just as beneficial to other studios as they launch their own in the same regard. So that's very cool. All right, now, as I said, it seems under the right circumstances, people still like going to the movies. And a number of films flourished the week of Christmas, and they all have another week to go with New Year's. But this past week for Christmas, many of them posted gains instead of losses. Now, Jumanji had the biggest surge. It was nice to see another surge for the film, as the first one so famously did. But 17 days out, while Star Wars is staying neck and neck from movie to movie, the same can't be said for the Jumanji films. And it seems unlikely that the second entry will come close to a billion like the first did. I think that Jumanji 2 was such a pleasant surprise, everyone discovered it. But with this one, it's more of the same. So I think it'll probably be a very big hit on streaming. They set up a third film, and I think they'll make it. And I hope they've learned their lessons. All right, then, while both have been snubbed during award season so far, we still have the Oscars to go, and some of the Guild Awards, too. Writers, directors, producers, Guild. But Little Women and Uncut Gems got their revenge, sort of, at the box office this week. But look at this audience breakdown for Little Women. 63% female, 73% Caucasian. Wow! Greta Gerwig and her, went to see this movie. That makes this very clearly a niche film. Not that there's anything wrong with that. But it's no Downton Abbey, made for under $20 million, which opened at $31 million. Although, of course, Downton Abbey was coming off of an incredibly successful pop culture iconic run on the small screen. So Little Women doesn't have that benefit. In fact, it has a little bit of a detriment that it's been done so many times up until now. But to truly be a success, especially with a $40 million budget, not including advertising, Little Women really needs to be a big awards contender, especially if it can't expand its audience but beyond this. I saw an article about maybe they should have had Laurie be an actor of color, because in the novel, they really played up the fact of his Italian heritage and having dark skin and dark hair and eyes. I think he was just Italian, and at that time, that's how it was conveyed. I think Little Women is a perfect movie, and I think that there's nothing wrong with telling a story as is. Not everything needs to be updated. I think it represents the time period it's in. Maybe they could have chosen an Italian actor who, they have that French actor in there who's quite good. He's a little bit darker in complexion. I think there's something to be said for choosing an Italian actor or an actor of Italian descent with that darker complexion. But Timothy Chalamet is so amazing in the role. I'm reluctant to say anything against him being cast when he does not go against. He has an Italian look to him. He doesn't go against. They didn't whitewash the role. So I don't know if this story could have been expanded for people to for a bigger audience in terms of representation. I mean, either you're interested in the story of Little Women or you're not. And I wish the budget were a little lower. Although it's hard for me to say anything negative against this because I love how it turned out so well. If they needed $40 million, they needed $40 million. But it would have been great if they could have made it for a little bit less. But it needs to be a big awards contender, I think, to drive its business on home release and streaming. But right now, it only has 2 Golden Globe noms and was shut out at the SAG Awards, which is a troubling sign for the Oscars, as the SAG, the actors are the biggest voting bloc in the Academy. So we'll see. We'll see how Little Women fares with the Oscar nominations when they're announced mid-January. So that's what's going on with Little Women. It just started, but it's a very solid, strong start. People are looking at it in a positive way. As for Uncut Gems, that was also shut out by SAG and by the Golden Globes. Nada! And audiences didn't care for it either, giving it a C+ cinema score. I feel audiences, some people really like it, but some people really hated it. And I was like, why is this? So I went in and I read a lot of the audience reviews on Rotten Tomatoes. I still don't think that's a valid source, the audience score, because it's voluntary. But I just wanted to see some of the things people said. And I thought what was interesting there is that I think a lot of people went expecting your typical Adam Sandler movie and, of course, didn't get it. But also, A24, I think in hindsight, it was a mistake to go wide with this movie on Christmas Day, because a lot of people, it seems, made it their Christmas Day movie of choice, and it was not good for the family with being such a bleak film. I mean, there's clear audience interest in Uncut Gems. Even after it debuted and got hit really strong with a bad word of mouth, it's still doing solid business day to day. I mean, I think maybe if it had gone wide on New Year's Day instead of Christmas Day, maybe audiences wouldn't have turned on it as they have. And not all audiences, but it's not good. Spies in Disguise also hit theaters, doing very similar business to Blue Sky's Ferdinand back in 2017. Tom Holland and Will Smith could not help this movie, which is, I think, a little troubling for the upcoming Onward from Pixar, which, of course, also has Tom Holland as a voice. And we'll see how the Pixar originals do this coming year. Their trailers have not lit the internet on fire. But with Frozen 2 still in theaters and still dominating, clearly Disney has some work to do in balancing out their animation brands post the Fox acquisition. And it seems their solution, at least in the near future, is to be Blue Sky Studios' next animated film in January 2022. January! Wow, that's like, Blue Sky's like, if you don't want to have us as part of the company, just say so. They're like, no, it's going to be a slow death. All right, so anyway, as for Cats, speaking of, this was quick. The feline fantasy seems to have zero lives at the box office, and the trades are reporting an expected loss of $71 million for Universal, which hopefully doesn't make the studio gun-shy when it comes to adapting another hit musical on Broadway, Wicked, which they've been sitting on now for years. I mean, everybody wants to see it get made, but I'd be a little nervous about musicals after this if I were Universal. Although, did you see what you were putting out there? All right, so. Then in limited release, 1917 opened in too many theaters to post a headline making per theater average. You really should only open in four theaters. You know, 11's nuts. Sometimes five, but even five I think is too many. Two in LA, two in New York. That's how you do it. But that's what Just Mercy did. It opened in four theaters, but it couldn't make any headlines either with its per theater average. Both, I think, go wide on the 10th, so we'll see how they do when everybody has a chance to weigh in with their ticket purchases. Now, as for this coming weekend, while no movies again open for New Year's Day, The Grudge will sneak into theaters on Friday. And what do you know is expected to not embarrass itself. And so I want to know, what movies do you plan to see as 2019 comes to a close? And remember, you have until the end of New Year's Day to vote in Beyond the Trailer's annual poll for the best and worst movies, which I will then reveal in a video. The link is down below in the video description. And again, you have until the end of the day on New Year's Day to cast your votes. So that's this week's Movie Math. Thanks for going over the box office with me. Be sure to share your thoughts down below. Subscribe today. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.